what does 178 rupees per day sound like as a minimum wage that you might earn for a full day's of work? It does not sound like a lot. In fact, what it might result in is for you to cut back on what you eat, cut back on what you spend on health, on transportation. It'll actually keep you hungry for most part. 178 is the minimum wage that has been declared as national floor wage. That is the abiding wage that we go by currently in this country. And this is what we have to bring into question today. The point is that everybody has a job. Everybody finds a job. And we do not have a job crisis. I think we have a wage crisis. The problem is that everybody finds a really bad job, right? And which is why they come back in debt or with just enough that will see them through a few weeks, and then they will have to turn to debt or some other form of financing in order to make ends meet for their households. Right. Minimum wage kind of framework and the minimum wage paradigm. Currently, so we have a minimum wage, which every state declares. And then there is a aspirational, and no, I shouldn't say aspirational, there is a national minimum floor wage, which has been declared by the government. Okay. The national floor minimum wage is currently rupees 4,576 rupees per month, which is what our government deems everyone must earn. It is as low as 175 rupees a day. This is unimaginably low. It is actually a starvation wage. Okay. Fortunately, most people earn above that. Okay. But not a lot above that. Not a lot above that. In 2019, government's own committee determined that the national minimum floor wage should at least be 9,750. So we are miles away from even establishing that kind of floor wage, which is 375 rupees a day. Okay. What happens instead is that almost about 33% of the entire workforce actually does not even earn a minimum wage, 33%. Okay. And those who do might earn a wage, but will not have any social security, will not have any accident cover, will not have health insurance, will not have a pot of money to turn to in case of a shock or a crisis like the COVID crisis presented. What are we doing here? You know, what we are doing is actually creating a vast army of surplus labor from rural areas that is being driven out of poverty and ready to join the urban economy at the lowest price point that it is offered. It has very little negotiating power, right? There is, of course, a disparity between rural wages and urban wages. You know, even currently, urban wages are twice the rural wages. Okay, so what a person will earn in rural areas will be half of what he or she might earn in the urban areas, and that itself is a big pull. You know, even if expenses are high, at least the cash that that person is earning will be more, more obtained in urban settings, right? However, within the urban areas, the difference between casual workers and workers who are more regular, that is very, very distressing. It's almost twice. It means that even today, a casually employed worker, somebody that you pick up from a labor point or who comes and works for you a few days a month, might earn 180 to 200 rupees on an average per day. However, a regular worker is likely to earn 370 to 400 rupees. Okay, that is the kind of norm in the urban areas, right? Of course, these are averages, and I know regional differences do prevail on these kinds of statistics. Gender disparities are, are too well known in our economy. And women for the same kind of work will earn 30% to 40% less. You know, and we have in a way normalized that kind of distinction. It has happened in the past, and it is happening even more increasingly, is that actually wages are getting delinked from time spent on a piece of work. Almost 50% of the entire workforce is not being paid a daily wage. They're actually self-employed people or working on completion of a certain task, okay? Which means that there is no way to understand what is owed to a person regardless of the time that he or she has spent on a task. And this is one way, a new way that has been found by many, many sectors of the industry, many, many parts of the economy, to keep wages low, to keep labor payments low, because the work has to be then, as the compensation has to be estimated on based on work and its quality. Okay, and that is happening even more and more as we go forward, recovering from the COVID, post-lockdown, we are seeing more and more of this happening. Overall, what does this result in? Firstly, workers and their households will be forced to cut back on the essentials. Okay, which means that in urban areas, workers will actually choose not to live in, you know, rented houses and homes. They will find open pavements, and they will find open spaces to sleep, to cut back on rentals, you know, to not pay rents. They will actually forego one meal in order to save up money that they have to send back home, right? Which is why we have one of the largest, most severely malnourished adult workforce anywhere in the world, with the lowest BMIs, okay? It is because people are just not getting enough money to feed themselves. We still find, this is 2021, we find large numbers of cases of workers paying off their debt through their work. It's called debt bondage. You know, this is a form of modern slavery, which ought not to have, not ought to exist at this point in our kind of glorious, you know, kind of, is actually early exit from the market. When wages don't rise with time, actually workers find it difficult to sustain in urban areas. They will come back. And they will try and do other, get engaged in other forms of marginal work, even if it is lower waged, in back at home. And it will be time for their children to start migrating, right? Which is the whole cycle of early entry into the market, but also early exit, because wages are not going up. One would imagine that, you know, shocks and, you know, setbacks will affect everybody equally. But they don't seem to. Let's just take a look at, you know, what is happening on the corporate India side. And I certainly don't hold the, you know, the mandate to condemn the choices that corporate India makes. But I think some facts are worth reflecting on. I think it is no secret that there are very stark kind of, you know, differences and disparity within corporate salaries. Okay. And these are, this is public information, right? So key managerial personnel and their salaries, their remuneration, and the median remuneration within companies, there are huge kind of gaps within that. It can go up to 1:700 in some extraordinary cases, but it is no less than 1:200. Then that I'm talking about the median vis-a-vis the key management personnel remuneration, right? The pay ratios are absurdly high right now, right? In 2017, the average top executive earned 88 times more than the average worker within the same company. Okay, that is just recently as that. And of course, these are companies that can assert that they are doing, performing well, consumer staples, consumer discretionary products, IT, telecom, you know, so they are well within the right to reward their senior management and their senior executives. But look at what we found, that companies facing serious stress internally, high debt burdens, unable to pay interests, they're, you know, kind of defaulting on their own interest repayments, but also hiking up corporate salaries at the senior management. That does not bode well for where priorities lie. You know, companies in stress, companies in you know, facing debt burdens have to rationalize their costs, not pay, you know, such large amounts of money to their senior executives. I think perversity in what we are deciding to pay our consultants, what we are deciding to pay as salary, as sitting fee to directors, and as commissions in our, in order to sustain the idea of a gloriously well-functioning corporate enterprise. You know, I'm saying this because there is now evidence available that some rationalization of that cost will result in better distribution downwards. A friend of mine was doing some crude mathematics, and she showed me how for 6 companies that she calculated, that the top 10 people, what they were paid and their commissions and their ESOPs and everything together, could actually pay the entire social security bill for the entire contract workforce in that company. Okay, which was not really, you know, that was the kind of payout which was happening. So there is a problem in the way we have normalized wages, poor wages at one end of the economy where millions live, and very high and inexplicably, you know, almost incomprehensibly rising salaries and benefits for another segment of the economy. People do that, but we have to think about what we do. What is the way forward here? I think we have to first, and COVID again tells us this, that we have to seriously look at creating wage protection for informal migrant workforce. Okay, that there has to be some semblance of dignified wages, which is not just about being legally compliant by paying them just a little bit more than what the national minimum floor wage is offering, but actually thinking about what dignified wages, which will help people keep body and soul together, but do more than that. Help them be create and engage more effectively with the society, with the economy, in their social and cultural life, right? What is that figure? You can determine, you can of course differ from region to region and from context to context. But certainly a good figure to go by is what a lot of labor activists are talking about today. Okay, 600 rupees a day as a minimum wage, worth thinking about. Okay, this is what it takes to keep a family going. Assuming that there'll be one or one and a half persons in a family fending for a family of, you know, 5 to 7 people. Okay, let's at least think about that, and let us see if it is possible to do our business modeling on those kinds of minimum wage levels. It is really important also to think about creating unemployment insurance now. Okay, given the fact that there is large numbers of people who can get exited from the market involuntarily, they may be available for work but will not find work. I think it is time to conceive of an unemployment insurance that works without significant entry barriers for a major amount of the workforce. There has been talk about offering wage subsidies to small enterprises. Okay, and this is a matter of contention because a lot of economists have argued in favor of wage subsidies to be offered by way of, say, tax credits to small enterprises, so that they're incentivized to hire and pay people at least a certain level of, you know, a dignified, scale. And so we should, you know, we ought to think about that, you know, quite seriously as a national program and as a national kind of a payout to the workforce likely to remain informally employed for most part. We have to argue together for escalating this absurd amount of national floor minimum wage. It has to be a signal that reaches out to large sectors of the economy that this is just not acceptable. We have to also, especially, and I say this to, you know, friends in the industry, we have to start examining downstream wages. You know, your businesses, your surpluses have a huge impact on yourselves, on your workforce, but it has a cascading effect down, you know, also has a huge cascading impact downstream. Public provisioning, especially to workers who are low-wage workers with unstable incomes, which means housing, food, nutrition, healthcare, has to become way more effective and way more available, not just by offering, you know, coupons or vouchers, but actually making services available so that people are able to save money, which can then be considered for passing down below, you know, should be seen not just as a moral kind of a argument, but also as an economic argument. When you pass down further below, then you probably will increase the productivity of the workforce that is depending on you, right? These are, of course, all radical steps. What happens instead is that we see a lot of strong belief that poor people should be virtuous, you know, that they should save, they should not drink, they should not spend too much money on social, you know, expenditures, you know, those kinds of. So virtuosity in poverty is often kind of offered as a solution for people to slide out of poverty. I do not think that will work. We have to have the same, you know, principles across the country, regardless of what we earn. The same morality must apply. And I therefore argue for reconsidering the very foundations of wages and incomes that our economy is built on.